Welcome back. So we'll continue our lectures on the polar coordinates and the geometric interpretations. So I will give you now the geometric interpretation of your addition and multiplication, and I'm sure most of you are familiar, but those who are not familiar can see this one. So let's start with this. So you have your complex plane. So what's the one thing? When you have a complex number z here, and then it's just a reflection, you get your z bar. So such that this angle is the same as this angle. Picture doesn't look nice. Okay, so you have your angle. Okay, so this angle is the same as this angle. Of course, this is 2 minus theta, you get. But the angle wise, the numerical value of angles are the same. So you have your z bar here. X minus iy, this is your x plus, z is equal to x plus iy. You already seen that this is your node z, which you are already seen in that figure. And then if you do this one, so what is your minus z? Minus z is minus x minus iy. So if this is your x, this is your y, iy, so your minus I will be here, iy, and minus x will be the same distance. You look at it minus x. So you have this point here, so you just reflect. This is your minus z. So as a position vector, you have this direction, you have to understand that one. So as a position vector, you have this direction. As a position vector, you have this direction. And the angle will be the same as this angle will be the same as this angle. And this distance is modulus of minus z. But modulus of minus z is same as mod z. So this distance from here to here is the same as here to here. That's the same as here to here. So you have all these, modulus of z is equal to modulus of minus z. This is the same as modulus of z bar or minus z bar. Everything all have the same modulus. So that is about z and z bar. Now what about your addition? So let's draw various pictures. So you have your two vectors now. Suppose p equal to x plus iy and your q is equal to x x1 plus iy1, I want to do it, and x2 plus iy2. Yeah, one more thing probably I have not introduced here in the polar coordinates. I need a notation. So with this Argand's diagram, I have some notation here, you can write it. So I have one more definition, okay? The definition of e power I theta. This is my definition, okay? This is just a notation and a definition. This I call it r into cos theta plus I sin theta, okay? R into x cos. So this just a definition, not have anything. But maybe in the next lecture or soon, later you will see that we will see later a definition of e power z for any z in C. Okay? Then you can see that this definition, when you put z equal to I theta, coincides with this definition. That's an important remark. For the time being, I want to make it. So right now, I am not defining e power I theta as an expansion. I am defining e power I theta as this way. So if you do that one, what do you get it here? This is r cos theta plus r sin theta. So you can write your x plus iy, z is equal to x plus iy. I can write my complex number, x equal to r cos theta, this is r sin theta, I can write it, this is e power I theta, there is no r there, cos theta plus I sin theta, okay, there is no r here, so you can, I can write it as cos theta, r sin theta, that will be r e power I theta. So this z equal to r e power I theta, where r is a non-negative number. And theta, you can take it as between 0 and theta 2 pi. And this is called the polar representation of the complex number. This is the polar representation of the complex number. Okay. With that polar representation, I can, if you look at here, I can also do that. If you have e power I theta 1, if I have two numbers, e power I theta 1 into e power I theta 2, you can do your trigonometric quantity identity of cos theta and sin theta, because this will be cos theta 1 plus I sin theta 1 into cos theta 2 plus I sin theta 2, and you expand it, use the trigonometric formula, you can also prove this identity in this definition. So this identity is also true, which you will see it for general. But for the time being, even with this definition and with your trigonometric formulas which you have studied in your 12th standard, you can prove this result. I need this here. Okay. So first let us see the sum. I will see the sum. How do you get it? So you I have two numbers. This is my P. I want a geometric representation. This is my P of Z. So it means P of X plus I Y. I have, I'm a bit worried. You may think that it is a polynomial. It is not. So you have your P here. And you have your Q here. Okay, I have my Q here. So I have a polar representation. This one for Z is equal to R1 e power I theta 1. And this is my ZW. So W is equal to R2 e power I theta 2. So I will get Z plus W equal to, I want to know what is my Z plus W. My question is, what is this one geometrically? Now I use the vector calculus here. So this will have an angle theta 1. This will have an angle theta 2. Okay. So what do I do is that you complete your parallelogram. So if this is equal to Z, this is equal to Y, and you connect this one, okay? And that is what your chalk is meant. And that is what going to be your Z plus W. This is the vector Z plus W. That will be vector Z plus W. So what do is that? You take your P here and then Q here, join the parallelogram and then get it, okay? And then that is the vector and you can compute it. You may not be able to write it this way. It will be R1 e power I theta 1 plus R2 e power I theta 2. For the product, you will be able to write it. So what about the subtraction? Z minus W. That's easy again. So you have your geometry. You have your Z here. That's what your Z point. And of course, this is your modulus, and then you may have your W. So you have your W here. This is your P point. This is your Q point. I'm writing. This is writing it as a complex number. So what to write it? Z minus W is nothing but Z plus minus W. And we have already seen that minus W is that you extend it here with the same thing. So this is your minus W. Okay, so this is this vector, this is vector in terms of vector this one. So I want to know Z plus minus W. So you complete your parallelogram. Okay, and then do this one. Okay, if this is again not very nice, you can draw it. So you will have your, okay. And this is your Z minus W. This is your Z minus W. That's fine. So you have your all addition and subtraction. And let's now go to the
another one. Okay, let me complete all these figures here so that it will start something there. So what do you want to do it? Now we want to understand ZW. In polar coordinate, sometimes polar coordinate is easy, sometimes your normal coordinate is easy. To understand these two, you have used, you didn't use much of polar coordinate, you are basically used in this representation, x plus I y format. But polar coordinate, now z by w is equal to r1 e power I theta 1 into r2 e power I theta 2. And using this formula which we have defined, r1, r2, this is a real number, positive real number, I theta 1 into e power I theta 2, we already have this formula. So I theta 1 plus theta 2. Okay. So that was much more easier. So this is now easy to represent in this polar coordinates. So you have your z here. Okay, r, this distance is r1, this angle is theta 1, and this is z here, and that is your point P if you want in terms of, and you have your theta 2 here, so that is your r2, this is your w, a point Q here, and this is your theta 2. So what do you want it here? You want your argument to be, this is your argument of the product. So theta 1 plus theta 2 is the argument. So you have to take theta 1 here and then product of r1 and r2. So r1 and r2, of course, if it is a small r1 and r2 are less than 1, r1 r2 will be a small number. So it need not be a big number. It depending on how big is r1. If r1 and r2 are greater than 1, r1 r2 will be bigger. So whatever it will come, so you make an angle here, so from here you want another angle theta 1, and then this will be your, this angle will be again theta 1. So this total angle will be theta 1 plus theta 2, okay. So you will have, so this distance will be r1, r2, and this will be your ZW. Alright, so there is another way of seeing this also. So this point, let me, if you connect this point, so you see this distance is r2, this is distance is r2, and this distance is a multiple of r1. And if I choose a point something here, what point I should choose? So these two triangles are similar. You see, these two triangles will be similar if I choose this to be 1. Right? Sorry, correct only, but because of the light, so let me write r1 here. So this is r1, so which is a multiple of 1 here, this is a multiple of 1 here. So if I call this point to be r, I call, what I am telling is that triangle OAQ, OAP and triangle OQR are similar. You have, if you want to draw, say, use the similar triangle concept. Now come to the last portion of it, the division. Division always will have slight difficulty in doing it. So I will mark it here, z1 by z2. If I do this one, z by w, so I use that notation, z by w, z is r power r1 by r2, so you get your modulus easily, these are all easy, and e power I theta 1 minus theta 2. To give a better picture, so let me take in a slightly different way, because I, of course you need not have to be theta 1 bigger or theta 2 bigger, but if theta 1 is bigger, I take p here, so I will have, so I have my p here, so this is my p, so this is my r1, this is my theta 1. So and then I will have my theta 2 here, So this will be my R2. This my is my Q here. This is the point Z. This is the point W, very clearly. And this is the angle theta 2. That's the angle theta 2. So what do I want? The angle theta 1 minus theta 2. So I have to take an angle theta 1 minus theta 2 here. Okay. And you get a point R here. Okay. So exactly you will get this angle should be theta 1 minus theta 2. And you can again prove this triangle here. Now the triangle, you take A here. So this angle, so this is R1, this is R2, and this distance OR, this is nothing but R1 by R2. So you have your triangle R1 by R2. So you get triangle here. Again, these two triangles are same. This is 1, so you take 1. So that is true. This R2, how do you get R1? If you multiply R2 by R1 by R2. So the factor which you want to multiply to get R1 plus from R2, you multiply R2 by R1 by R2. R2, R2 cancel, you get it. That's what you hear also. You multiply 1 by R1 by R2, you get this angle. So that way, this triangle OPQ, now it is different. Okay, OPQ and triangle OAR similar. So you have to understand that points. Okay. What else is remaining in this polar coordinate structure? You have polar coordinates and all the geometric interpretations properly. So let's do something interesting for you. Yeah, one more issue if you want to. From here you understand something. So just like what we have done, modulus of something is you multiply modulus of Z, W is equal to R1, R2, you get amplitude or Z1, Z2 is equal to amplitude of Z1. This is a new formula you observe, right? Amplitude of Z2 or W. Similarly, amplitude of Z1 by Z2 or Z by W, whichever notation, that's immaterial. Amplitude of Z1 minus amplitude of Z2. You see, you have some nice formula. So you know that the modulus of the product is the product of the modulus, and the modulus of the division is the division of the modulus. On the other hand, amplitude sums up. Okay, so the amplitude of Z1, Z2 is amplitude of Z1 plus amplitude of Z2, and amplitude of Z1 by Z2 is amplitude of Z1 minus amplitude of Z2. So you, I think you now have a sufficient amount of information with you to understand the complex analysis and complex number system together with its operations. What is other applications is that, just like you have seen that the complex numbers can be associated with your vector calculus little bit, you can also represent various regions using, since you have associating in the complex plane, can represent various regions in on the plane, regions on the plane. This has a substance on the plane. Quite often, representing the regions on the plane via complex numbers is much more convenient. Because you have a very nice theory of complex analysis, and you can represent the regions in terms of complex in a more nice way. For example, there are various things which you can do it and work it out. As I said, this is that much. This is not a kind of full course in complex analysis, which is itself is a. If you want to really learn some complex analysis, some important things, you need a one full semester course even to learn the basics. We are trying to give you some aspects of complex analysis in two semesters, two modules, which is essentially a one full course of 40 hours, which is not affordable. Yeah. So for example, you look at this set of all points, z equal to 1. What is this? You see, you want to see the set of all complex numbers C. Can you see? So this is a region in which your modulus is constant, which is 1. And you can see that this is nothing but the unit circle. So your unit circle can be represented in this way. And more generally, if you put the set of all things where modulus is constant, that means your distance is not changing. When the distance is not changing, it is nothing but the circle, and this is the center. And so this is the origin, and this is your R. On the other hand, if I write set of all z such that mod z minus z naught is equal to R, z naught is fixed, z naught in C fixed. Just work it out. You have other equations in the analytic geometry like x square plus y square equal to r square. This is the same. So that's why you have a more convenient way of writing. And this is nothing but the circle. This is the circle with center z naught. You will look for formulas, right? Z naught and radius. Okay. So with radius r. So you have get some other circle. Okay, this is set naught and you have radius r. So only this point. Okay, I'll use this a little later. Okay. And then similarly, you can ask for a radius for which your amplitude is constant. You want to know the set z such that your amplitude is amplitude of z minus set naught is equal to a constant theta, constant. That means you are, what do you think of a amplitude? So let's look at it geometrically. What does that, you have points z naught here. You want to find all those points. I want to understand this set. The set of all points z such that amplitude of z minus z naught is equal to 1. What is z minus z naught? If you, so I want to find the points here for which this formula is true. So if I take a z somewhere here, anywhere, I don't know where it is, what I want to understand this relation. What is my z minus z naught? So if this z is a point here, my z, this is my, in a vector, this is my z, this is my z naught. So what do I get it z minus z naught? So this plus this, that's what, if as in a vector notation, this z naught plus this vector equal to this vector. So you have a correct direction. This plus this equal to this. So this minus this is equal to true. So this is the vector z minus z naught. Okay. Please understand that one. So if that is the vector z minus z naught, so as z varies, I will get another z minus. If I my z is here, I will get this. The condition I want it, I want my amplitude to be the same. I don't want to amplitude is same. What is the amplitude? You extend this line, this is my amplitude. You see, if I take a point z here, my z minus z naught will be this one. And I get a different angle. And so this is the set of all points. If the amplitude is constant, I have to move my z along only this line. So z minus z naught for which amplitude is constant is a z straight line passing through z naught making an angle theta. So it's a straight line passing through z naught and making an angle theta. Making an angle theta with the positive x axis. Positive x axis. Okay, so that's it. So you straight lines can be represented in this form in terms of the complex numbers. What more I do have it? So I can even represent the regions now. With this is over. So I can continue here in this thing. So with this object, if I have this set of all z such that theta 1 less than or equal to amplitude of z less than or equal to theta 2, what does this mean? So please understand all these things. What is amplitude of z equal to theta 1? Z equal to theta 1? Amplitude of z equal to theta 1? Set of all z such that amplitude is of z equal to theta 1. By this argument, it is a straight line passing through, it is a straight line passing through the origin. In this case, z naught is equal to 0. This is nothing but z minus 0. So this is a straight line passing through the origin and making an angle. So you will have this one. And you want that, a region here, okay? And maybe a region here. That is what. And similarly, if this is theta 1 and this is theta 2, I want a region between theta 1 and theta 2. So you can represent such conical regions using this kind of amplitude concepts, okay? So like that, you can, for example, there are other regions which you can represent. So many regions you can represent. For example, suppose I want to know this region such that real part of z is greater than or equal to some real number alpha. What is this region? Real part. So this is real part should be, so this is this region. If I take less than, I get this region. Instead of real, if I use imaginary part of less than or equal to a, I will get this region. So half planes. So what is the upper half plane? Upper half plane, this region is nothing but your imaginary part of z is positive. What is this lower half plane? Imaginary part is negative. Okay. And what is the right half plane? Is the real part of z is positive. What is the left half plane? It is real part. What is this quadrant thing? This is imaginary part is positive and the real part is positive. So that way you can represent various regions in the plane using the complex endeavors, which will be quite often very convenient to do the problems. All right, so that is the topic which we have done. Now what do we do it? I want to do something before, two more things I want to complete it if possible today. Okay, one important result I want to recall, what is called the De Moivre's theorem. IVRES, De Moivre's. Again, you would have used this so much in your 12th class, 11th and 12th class. What does that say? You know, e power I theta, which I have defined it as cos theta plus I sin theta. So because of that, what would be my e power n theta cos the n theta plus I sin n theta. So what De Moivre's theorem tells you is that if I do this way, sin theta whole power n is equal to cos n theta plus I sin n theta. Or that means, as I say, if I take e power I theta and its power, I will get it as e power I n theta. This is quite useful. You can prove it probably in different ways. One way of proving for n equal to 2, this is quite easy. You can prove it if you want it. The other way to prove is use the mathematical induction. So anyway, I'm not going to tell you something more about it. I want to give an application of De Moivre's theorem in the solvability question. That's what I'm going to do it. Solvability, which I may do it here. So let me do the most important question we set out in the beginning, in the motivation. Define the square roots of negative numbers, which to some extent we already reached. We already proved that square root of thing can be solved in that one. What I am going to do it here, you can do it much more than that. Okay, so I am going to tell you the solvability, very general solvability, okay, for z power n. We are working with, here I want to make an interesting remark before going that, where z naught belongs to C is given. I want to find z of all that. So let me, probably now you are wondering, yesterday morning we have started with n, then we want to solve it x plus n equal to m, you introduce z. That means the integer number system. Then we wanted to solve ax equal to b, then you introduce q. After qing, you want to solve x square equal to a, the quadratic equation x square equal to a, in particular x square equal to 2. Then you introduce the real number system. And you notice that x square equal to, when it is a negative number, you can't take a negative thing. X square equal to thing. So you may be wondering, so with that, so far, in the first three lectures, we have achieved that x square equal to a can be solved for any a, positive or negative, including negative. So you may now start wondering, what will happen to x cube? What will happen to x power 4? Each time, do I need to invent a new number system? Suppose I go to cubic equation. Do I need a new number system than the C? Do I need to enlarge my complex number system? Then x power 4, do I need another system? X power 4, 5, do I need? Keep on going x power n equal to, or z power n equal to, do I need a new system? The remarkable and beautiful theorem is that the C gives you solutions to everything. You don't have to look for any new number system further. That is what the famous fundamental theorem of algebra. Fundamental theorem. Okay. Every nth degree polynomial, in every nth degree polynomial, polynomial equation, every nth degree polynomial equation, that is sigma an z power n, n equal to 0 to ak z power k, let me write it, k equal to 0 to n equal to 0, this is an nth degree, ak of course you need an not equal to 0, has a root in C. You don't have to develop new number system to solve the polynomial equation. Root in C. In fact, it can be factorized. It can be factorized. Okay. And factor, not only it can be factorized, and all the solutions, you can actually prove that an nth degree polynomial equation has exactly n roots in C. Some of the roots may coincide. For example, if I take z minus 1 equal to 0, I square equal to 0. Of course, z equal to I is a root. Then that is repeated. That's called its multiplicity and all things. Let me not go into that. But by repetition, you can actually prove that every polynomial equation has a root. And you don't have to worry. So the number system which now we have developed in terms of C is in some sense is a very good system where you can solve all the polynomial equations. What I want, that is on the, so you may see several proofs in the literature. Those who are interested can see that one. What I am going to do is that I am going to give you the exact solutions of that. I am not going to find all the n roots of this equation with z naught in C. That means, in fact, you can put negative number here and I can find the thing. Okay, that's what I, and this polar coordinates helps me with the de Moivre's theorem. Okay, so let z naught is equal to r naught e power I theta naught. And look for, so we want to understand the solubility of z power z naught, that's what we are discussing, where z naught is a given C, so the given in C, so this is given, so r naught and theta naught. You want to look for, or you want to find r and theta such that z equal to r e power I theta, and which should solve this equation. So substituting in one, what you will get is that r e power I theta whole power n is equal to r naught e power I theta naught. So by de Moivre's theorem, this will be r power n into cos n theta plus I sin n theta. So this should be equal to, so this immediately implies r naught is positive. Keep that in mind. R naught is positive. This implies r equal to r naught, which is a positive number. So you can take the nth power, nth root of that, which is known because it's a real number and you know the nth root of it. And you choose n theta equal to theta naught. N theta is equal to theta naught, or theta is equal to theta naught by n. Okay, so with that we will get a solution. So we will remove this. Okay, so we have a solution now. Thus r naught power 1 over n into cos theta naught by n plus I sin theta naught by n is a solution of 1. You see, so you have one solution immediately using this formula. So how do you find? As I said, the fundamental theorem tells you there are n roots. So I want to find, I use some important property now. Property of e power I theta. What is the property of e power I theta? It is periodic with period 2 pi. This periodicity comes from that, because e power from the sine and cosine function. In fact, for every k, not just thing. If I take this one, where k is 0 plus or minus 1, etc., this will be e power I theta. This is true for all k equal to 0 plus or minus 1 plus or minus 2, etc. That means you have a, by adding 2k pi, you get another, it is the same thing. So it is not going to change it. So instead of n theta is equal to theta naught, I can always add 2k pi. So I can get more solutions. You can verify this. More solutions. So I will put k equal to, you may see why I put only this one. I put only up to n minus 1. Put k equal to 0 to n minus 1. And you get solutions r naught. This I cannot change it. Because there is a unique nth root in as a real number for everything. So with this, I can put this one, because you can see that one. I will put cos of theta naught plus 2k pi by n plus I sin theta naught plus 2k pi by n. What happens here, if I take nth power of this, that n comes here, that n and n get cancelled, and then you get cos theta naught plus 2 k pi, and since cos theta and sin theta are periodic, that will be the same. This is nothing but r naught power 1 over n e power theta naught plus 2 k pi by n. These are all roots. So you will looks like there are infinitely many roots, because I can put k plus or minus 1, etc. But what one observation here, which I may write it here. If you look at it, k from 0 to n minus 1, these roots are distinct. K equal to 0 up to 1, etc. up to n minus 1. You get n roots, n nth roots. That's what you are there. Or you get n solutions of 1. What are the solutions of 1? All these things. R naught power 1 over n into e power theta naught plus 2 k pi by n, with k equal to 0, 1, 2, etc. n minus 1. Now, you may think what happens to other k. Suppose I take k equal to n. If I take k equal to n, what will happen? This will be 2 n pi, and it will be thing, and you will get back. So, and if I take n here, what will happen is that you multiply by n, and then you will see that you are getting back the first root. Okay. So, you will get with the 0 value. If I take n here, I'll get the same as 0. If I take n plus 1, I get 1. So it will repeat. So after k equal to n, etc., you get back the same roots. You don't get anything new. But these are all distinct. Okay. These roots are all distinct. So you have n distinct roots for this equation. And by the fundamental theorem of algebra, you have exactly n roots. In this case, the roots don't repeat. You have the n distinct roots. And for other k, gone. So you have the entire solution of this equation. Okay? That is what. So you have achieved the solvability of this equation. That's a very interesting thing. Very simple De Moivre's formula. Once you have. So we started with an equation, just x square, z square is equal to, or z square is equal to minus 1. Okay, so this is the one we have started. Just to solve this equation, we have introduced the complex number system. But the achievement of the new phenomena is that you are able to solve z power n into equal to z naught. Okay, so you want to, so you have all the roots here. Okay, so you have all the roots here. Okay, so this is a kind of fracture. You get all the nth power, you will get back your set naught, because the once more I am repeating, if you take nth power of this, this will become r, this will become theta e power theta naught plus 2 k pi, and but that is a periodic, you will get back your I theta naught. So that's a kind of success you achieved. So what is happening in this one? What is this thing? So let's look at it. So an example. Maybe I will remove this, because this is important to learn what we call it as nth roots of unity. You may need this in your future studies. Nth roots of unity. That means you want to solve the equation z power n equal to 1. So that is what you are trying to look. Look for that equations, nth roots of unity. So let's look at an observation. Of course, I can write down, because z naught is equal to 1. So what are all the roots here? You can, because r is, since it is 1, r naught is equal to 1, theta naught is equal to 0. So that's why my theta naught equal to 0. In this case, theta naught is equal to 0, z naught is equal to 1. This is equal to, That implies my r naught is equal to 1 and my theta naught is equal to 0. So what are all my nth roots of unity? I can write nth roots of unity are given by e power r naught is 1, it does not produce anything. Theta naught is 0, it doesn't produce 2 k pi by n. All the nth roots, all the nth roots of unity are given by where k is equal to 0, 1, 2, 3, up to n minus 1. So, this has a very special notation. What happens when k equal to 0? When k equal to 0, since there is no theta naught here, k equal to 0, this will be e power 0, which will be 1. Okay. So, when k equal to 0, you get 1. So, I will give a notation omega. This is the fundamental nth root of unity, the first one. We will see in pictorially. This is nothing but I will call it k equal to 1, 2 pi by n. So, that is when k equal to 1, you get the, so the first root is when k equal to 0. Okay. So, when k equal to 0, it gives you 1, right, root. When k equal to 1, it gives you omega by this notation. When k equal to 2, what you will get it? 2 pi by n into 2, which is the square, that gives you omega square. This is nothing but omega square when k equal to. So, you will get, this is nothing but 1 omega, omega square, etc. up to omega. I have not done anything new. The same thing I have substituted here. Okay. And that since it's a very special case, you will see. It would be interesting to, as an exercise, you do this. Exercise, you find all the nth roots of minus 1. Okay. I think very nice intuition about this thing, about these roots. So, let's take n equal to 8 for your comfort. So, there will be n roots. Okay. So, since z power n equal to 1, this immediately implies I can take modulus both sides, and then I know that modulus of z square equal to mod z into z, that is mod z into mod z, which is mod z square. So, mod z power n is equal to, mod z power n is equal to 1, that implies mod z power n equal to 1. What does that mean? This implies this is a real number. A real number power n equal to 1, and you get the modulus is equal to 1. Modulus is, of course, z modulus is equal to 1. What does this modulus of I have just now some time back, I told you this is an equation of a circle with radius 1 and center thing. That means all the roots has modulus 1. In other words, all the roots lie on a circle with origin as center and radius as 1. So, it lies on the unit circle. So, all the roots are modulus 1. So, what is the first root? This is my first root because it's 1. Then, when n equal to 2, this is pi by 4. So, this is your first root omega. This is your omega square. If you go here, this is your omega cube, this is your omega power 3, 4. If you do it, this is your omega 5, here you get omega power 6 and omega power 7. This is same as omega power 8. I told you when it reaches n, it will come back to the same thing. And this is true, the same thing is true. If you take any point, this is nothing special about 1. If I take any number a here which is positive, I can draw a circle with radius root a. You have to take it. If z power n is equal to a is positive, I take a circle with radius root a and it will rotate through that. And that's what this is also telling. It will rotate through the circle. If you want to do it z naught, you look at there. That's all. So, you can see that one. all these are roots, omega, omega square, omega cube, omega power, everything is a root of this. That means omega k, if you take the nth power of omega k, so naturally if I take omega, omega square, you will get it. If I take omega square as a root, omega square square is omega power 4, omega power, so you may take more and more rotations. If I take omega in the 8th power, you get here, if I take this as a root, in the 4th power I reach here one more 4th power. So indeed, what I want to tell you is that omega power 8 is equal to 1, that is why omega is a root. If I take omega square power 8, this is also 1. The only thing is that if I started my root here, in one step I will go here, second step I go here, third step I go here, fourth, fifth, sixth, and eighth only I will reach here. So by eighth time I will reach that root. If I take omega cube here, in omega cube square, second time I reach here, then third time I reach here, fourth time I will reach here, fifth time I reach here, sixth time I reach here, seventh time I reach here, eighth time I reach here. You see, this is rotating like that. So you can calculate all the nth roots of unity using that one. So one more thing I want to tell you here, very nice interesting identity. You know that omega power 8 equal to, not for this. Yeah, omega power 8 is equal to 1. Okay, in general, omega power n equal to 1. If omega power n is the nth root. So 0 is equal to 1 minus omega power n, omega power n. This you can write it as 1 minus omega into 1 plus omega plus etc. omega power n minus 1. You see? And one should do this one, this product is 0. But omega can never be 1. For anything, omega is here with an angle 2 pi by n. So this is for n equal to 8. In general, it moves. So in general, if you do this one, it will move an angle 2 pi by n. Second time, it will move, omega square will move, something like that. It will move like this. It will move like that. So omega can never be 1. So this can never be 0. That implies an important identity. If omega is the nth root of unity, I will get this is equal to omega power n minus 1 a is equal to 0. This is a very nice identity which we proved. Almost we got free. Okay. So what do I want to tell one more thing? Actually, there is one more section today to complete it. Probably that will be difficult. I will do that for the next thing. But I want you to tell you something interesting before I complete this lecture. I just want you to think about it. Something. I don't want you to eat something like an exercise. Suppose I have, so this is called a pure rotation. So you have a translation and a rotation. Probably I have not told you about that one. Maybe I will tell you something. So what is happening in all these roots? If you start from here, you have a circle, right? You can take it as a unit circle. So if I have an angle here, if I square it will go here. Cube it will keep on going. That is what will happen. It will keep on going like this. Each power, if I take a some omega here, it will be omega square, omega cube, yeah, or some number, whatever, if any rotation comes here, and it will go here, like this, it will go on doing that, okay. It may not, omega may reach, but if I take some angle, if I do that rotation, I may not reach here, it will keep on going, okay, in general, if I take some points of rotation. If I take some rotations here, okay, like that. I'm not explaining fully. It is nice to see. So I want to know when I take an angle, something like e power, some angle theta, This is something different from nth root of unity. I'm not talking about nth root of unity for the time being. I'm starting with an angle theta naught. So if I take its square, it will go to 2i theta naught. And it will keep on rotating. So I want to know, I want to know whether such kind of rotations will get back to my z naught or get back somewhere else. Maybe I will discuss this, it's not very clear to you for the time being. And maybe I will discuss this little more tomorrow about some sort of a rotation. And once you know the rotation, you will understand it. This is to just to begin, to play with you. You play with, you start a point, you take its rotations, not as a root of a unity, you just start with it, start as a rotation, and let's come back and then see tomorrow what we can do it. So one small section I have not completed, which I have planned it today, and that is more of a, so far what you have seen is then a C together with an algebra. Now what we will see is that a geometry, okay. So you have two important structures whenever you define a set with a set of operations, algebraic operations. So that means you are putting some algebraic structure on that set. Then you want to define something what we call it a geometric structure. This geometric structure is what we define, need to define continuity, differentiability and all that. And that's what the important topic which I'm going to discuss in the coming lectures. Okay, thank you.